In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Today, my beloved, is the third Sunday of the blessed month of Tuba. And the month of Tuba, we focus on the baptism and the mission of John the Baptist as to prepare the way for God, the incarnated Logos, Jesus Christ. And today, we see John is witnessing for God. Witnessing. He talked about his mission and who is he compared to Jesus. He is a friend of the groom, while Jesus, he is a true groom. And today also we celebrate the departure of the Holy Virgin Mary, 21st of Tuba. And tomorrow we celebrate the departure of Saint Anthony. So if I take John, his life and his witness, and if I take the Holy Virgin Mary as a role model, and if I take Saint Anthony as the father of all the monks around the world, I can say I see the cloud of witnesses witnessing for God, and this will be a message for us. A question I want to ask myself today, I'm witnessing for God or not? Let me just talk a little bit about this as we see it in John as he witnessed to the Lord Jesus Christ. In John today, he said, John 3, he who has a bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is fulfilled. A bride and bridegroom, a friend, and he stands and he is joyful because his joy is fulfilled today. Bearing witness to Jesus Christ is a duty of every believer. Many times when I speak with people, they think their mission is not to do sin only, not to sin. But we are not. There is no such a state where you are in the zero. You are not sinning, while not you are doing anything good. You cannot be this, either or. You are a sinner or a repentant. And when you are in a continuous repentance, you are glorifying God. That's why I'm not talking about John. I'm talking about each one of us as our responsibility to witness. Jesus had done for us what he did for us deserves a gratitude, dedication, and active efforts for him. He did a lot for us. We bear witness to Christ not only because we are grateful to him for saving us, blessing and choosing us as his children, but out of love for humanity. This means I'm not doing this only in reflection to Jesus, what he did, but I'm doing it because I have duty towards the humanity as I'm part of them. So if you are purified and motivated and sanctified by the work of God, you will see the humanity in a different way. They need the salvation you are enjoying. Bearing witness means demonstrating these divine characteristics while consolidating and deepening them in our Christian lives. In a very simple way, I will say what is in Proverbs, the generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. Where we can witness to Christ? First is personal holiness. I cannot refer to Jesus while I am in a wrong life. And here we use the word sanctification, means set apart for God. You know, in the Old Testament, the clergy, they used to have here a sign, wrote in it, holy for God, holy for God. And I will just give you a very simple example. When we come to the liturgy, we prepare the altar. We use plate and chalice and handkerchiefs. Those are consecrated for this work. Abuna will never one day have, for example, some sort of activity in the church and will tell them, we run out of plates, bring the chalice, bring the plate to use them. No way. I want you to think of yourself as consecrated vessel for God. You are consecrated vessel for God. You don't look around and compare yourself because you are not like anybody. Yes, we are the same human. The same material we use to make the plate and chalice, they are used in so many things. But the same material, like the body is the same. We are the same. But this consecrated with the holy myron oil, exactly like you guys consecrated by the holy myron oil 36 crosses. I want you to think of this always and say, I am consecrated for God. I am consecrated for God. I am the same material like others, but I am not behaving like others. Why? Because I am a temple of the Holy Spirit. This is the sanctification. Does not mean being sinless, because this is the first question, how we be like this and we live in the world. Abuna, after finishing the liturgy, they wrap everything and close it and never goes out of the altar. But we go out and we deal with people outside. So here, still I'm working on this analogy, huh? What to do? Here is the answer. Sanctification doesn't mean sinless, but means freedom from condemnation. What is the difference between being sinless and freedom from condemnation? Sinless means doesn't have any sin, doesn't do sin, and this is not a human nature. But free from condemnation, who is the one who sinned and repented? That's why the life of the Christian to be sanctified is equal to continuous repentance. And by continuous repentance, I don't mean you sit with Abuna day and night to confess your sins. I mean you have a clean and clear conscience inside. If I say by bad word, I feel something wrong and I need to confess it. But I don't say bad word every day. Okay? So if you want to be not condemned, you have a continuous kind of cleaning yourself. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from the body of death. And this is what St. Paul said in his epistle to the Romans, because he feels, yes, we are tempted by sin, and the body, our body, in spite of, is a great tool for us to support our spiritual life, but again, it's like a horse you need to train to ride, otherwise you will lose it. We may stumble, but we refuse to be enslaved by sin. I want this to be clear. We may stumble, but we refuse to be enslaved by sin. Sin that is caused by weakness in spite of struggle and efforts is normal and possible. But sin that is caused by negligence, rebellion, carelessness is rejected. And the epistle to the Romans saying, there is therefore not condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. I'm asked this question so many times, especially when we are on occasion of a departed beloved. God is not sitting to count your sins one by one. God judge the whole condition of your heart. And here we differentiate between two major situations. A heart who loves God but struggle, sin and repent, and a heart who doesn't care and does whatever. There is a huge difference between both. So I wish nobody is in this side, which is, I don't care, I'll do whatever I want to do. But we accept the weakness of our nature, and we accept that we can struggle, but Jesus made it open the door for repentance by his shed blood, which is unlimited. Sanctification means that a person sets himself apart from the normal life of the people of the world and consecrate the inner temple of his heart to the Lord. So I have sins surrounding me, but the temple inside is clean and clear. The personal holiness is by the grace of God and man's struggle. This is the equation. You have to keep this equation always in your mind. The equation is personal holiness equal grace of God plus man's struggle. Some people, they deny man's struggle and they put it all in God. Yes, without God you cannot do anything, regardless how much you struggle. But if you work with the grace of God, and this is a work is your human struggle, you will reach this human holiness. In the book of Matthew, he said, people may say your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. And this is what it's all about, witness. Witnessing is not by words. John today, he gave a sermon about who is Jesus. But people, they are not impacted by words. They are impacted by doing. I'll give you very simple examples. You go to work on time, and others, they play around. And the people around you, they say, wow, this guy is very accurate. For example, you don't lie. And this is one of the very good American values. I hope they keep it always. They don't lie. And people, they say, oh, this man, whatever the word he says, this is the truth. He said the truth and nothing other than the truth. This is a way of witnessing. And you get more, we will get to more kind of witnessing in your personal life. So the first area is the personal holiness. The second area is the family cohesion. Family cohesion. First is your personal holiness. Fighting, but with the grace of God, I'm holy. The second is family cohesion. Jesus taught us this. If the house is divided, who is the ruler of this house? You know the answer. What does it mean, family cohesion? Love and unity. Remember those words. Love and unity. We all love one another. We may disagree. We may have disputes. We may have discussions. Even if it is heated up because we don't know how to communicate. But we love one another. We love one another. And love is the name of God. God is love. Love means sacrificial love. And we are always united, not divided. This is a topic by itself. Christ's love bound the family members into one body. We can love one another because we are same blood or we have the same benefit. Like a wife, she will tolerate her husband because she wanna enjoy his money, for example. So there is unity for objective. Or a husband, for example, benefiting from the connections of his wife to support his business. So if they break, they lose. This is not unity. This is not unity. The unity comes from Christ's love who bound us. We are members or individuals in our behavior. What is the difference between individuals and members? Individual is self-centered. This is me. This is how am I. But member, we are like the members of the body, the organs of the body. So we work together. We support one another. The Christian person, he is a member of Jesus' body. And this is a whole church. And he is a member of the family, which is a small unit of the church or the body of Christ. So we need to keep this clear in our mind. We are not just individuals. Even if you are the greatest individual, you are nothing compared to the body of the family or the body of Christ. And this membership can be presented in Bible, prayer, fasting, communion, coming to church together On Sunday, we are one family, united together. And we hear this a lot. We feel jealous sometimes from neighbors from other religions. We see them on Saturday. They are walking together as a family, all ages, and they are going to worship. And they say, oh, this is a good family. Why? Because they are united together, and they work together, they pray together. The third area is the church service. So first, witness through your personal life. Number two is from the family. Number three, from the church service. Church service has so many ways. Giving your tithe, for example, is a kind of church service, because with this money, you feed others and you spread the word of God. God granted you talents and gifts. There is nobody without talent and gift. There is a nice program called Discover Your Talents. I wish we can run it with Sunday school. And they put many questions for the kids to discover their talents. And the great thing is to work with your talent, even in your study and in your work later on. So use your talents and gifts for the glory of God, for the church service. And nobody is without gift, but you cannot give it unless you discover it. Sunday school, etc., any kind of service. Serving in the church makes the believers living branches in Jesus' vineyard and develop a sense of belongings. I love this statement. You look at a vineyard, you see the branches, you don't see where the main, but you see a lot of branches. And the church is like this. We are all branches, living branches in it. If you read John 15, you will read about the vineyard and how Jesus, he is the juice, and we are branches in him. If we lose this juice, we die because we get hardened. The fourth area is the area of sacrificial love. And this is the greatest. By the way, those are organized in a manner you cannot jump to number two without number one, or number three without number one. And definitely you cannot reach sacrificial love without going through personal witness, holiness, family cohesion, and church service. This is the deepest and most profound area of witness. The believer comes out of his isolation and turns his attention outward to others in love. I wanted this to be, I will take the analogy of the fountain. The fountain is full of water, but the water goes by itself to others. Because sometimes people misunderstand this or misinterpret this by living outside himself. Then he dries from inside. And if I dry from inside, I cannot give anything outside. I hope I'm not complicating it. But you have to be continuously nourished by personal holiness to know how to give sacrificial love. Christ wants his children to have open hearts, spread love, and to serve with a noble and a good spirit. Each Christian is like a fiery pole of fire. If you put him in any place, he doesn't burn it. He energizes it by the love of God. You know, like the yeast, the another analogy. Instead of the ball of fire, because you may think burning, think of the yeast. If you put a little small piece of yeast in a bigger, it will turn the whole thing to something good. And the example is the Good Samaritan. Let us serve with all our love and energy without expecting a reward. This is the first obstacle we face. We face it because we expect a reward for what we do. Recompense or praise. Then we will have praise from God, and that is recompense enough. The rule is very well known. If you serve or if you witness to be regarded and seen, you are regarded on earth. But we look for the heavenly reward, not the earthly report. One of the desert fathers said, if you shut yourself up alone in a chamber to be alone with God and do not find consolation, go down to the street and you will find Christ in the first passerby. You will find Christ in the people around you if you cannot reach him alone. How do I overcome my fear of witnessing? Some people, they like to walk next to the wall. Trust that God will speak through you. The process is very simple, my beloveds. Submit yourself to God. God will sanctify you and use you. As simple as that. It's not as complicated as I explained it. It's very simple. Submit to God and tell him, here am I, work with me. He will work with you. In the book of Exodus, chapter 4, now therefore, go and I will be with your mouth and teach you what you shall say. In this chapter, there was a big dialogue between God and whom? Exodus 4, Moses. Moses, God kept telling him, you go, I will. Then he told him, see somebody else. And finally he went, but Aaron was his mouth. We trust that God will use us. Take courage and find strength in God's power, presence, and protection. And here in the book of Acts, the Lord spoke to Paul in the night by a vision. Do not be afraid, but speak and do not keep silent. We see all the martyrs, and this is the highest level of witnessing. If we look to their life, we will see this exactly happening. They trust in God and they have courage. All the martyrs like this, if we think about Damiana, we always praise Damiana and the 40 virgins, but historically, how many girls or how many people got martyred because of their faith when they saw Damiana going through the pain and suffering she had? So many, and we don't know even anything about them. We know so many, right? And this is coming from what? From the faith, trust, and courage of Damiana, right? The same, I'll keep repeating, the martyrs of Libya. The courage they showed, it was a Christian message to the whole world. This is what we see, what is behind the scene. We are eternal. We are not just dusty people here. For I am with you, and no one will attack you to hurt you, for I have many people in this city. So if God permitted the attack, it is good for you because you are upgraded to the martyr level. How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. I want you to remember this and tell yourself, this is the message today. I am a witness. I am a witness. Any word you say, any behavior you do, I hope we always have glad tidings and we have joyful message. And glory be to God forever. Amen.